Hi, everyone. I'm James Panazzo, director of Launch LA. Thank you very much for attending this artist conversation with Shana Nys Dambrot and our current artist, Ryan McCann. Shana's a longtime friend and supporter of everything that I've done over the years and many of the artists I work with. She currently is writing for Artbound, Art Limited, Flaunt, White Hot Magazine, and Vice, among others. Just a wonderful, very active set of eyes and ears on the scene in LA. We're thrilled to have her. This is a wonderful new series by Ryan, kind of a departure of what he normally does, but we'll talk about his very diverse art practice. And thank you all for coming. Without further ado, Shana Nys Dambrot and Ryan McCann.
Look at them all. There's like standing room only. I'm sorry I'm late. It was city planning. I gave myself what would be enough time in a normal city. I every once in a while forget we don't live in one of those. And I apologize. Thank you so much for not giving me a hard time about that, because I'm actually really excited. Well, first of all, I just want to say I love it when an artist has a moment where they're doing something that's like related to what you know what people have seen, but also has this element of total departure in the technique or something like that. Because that sort of makes my job easier, because I can start a conversation like this by saying, explain to these people what they're looking at and how you made them, because that's not just a point of curiosity. What you're actually doing to make these images has a lot of the meaning in itself, in the process. And also because it's some part invention on your part. You can't just say, oh, well, it's old school pyrography, and then everyone goes, oh yeah, I know what that is. So I would love it if we could just start in a really simple place, like how you made these.
Yeah, the process, I mean, these are photographs printed on this handmade rice paper. The way I came to the images, there's something between me and the subject, between the camera and the subject, and that is it. Once what you see on the wall is what I see in the camera, so meaning I don't take the image into Photoshop and play with it and do different things. This is what I see when I take a photograph. So, yeah.
And that's because of the way. I mean, is it sort of like a low lighting, long exposure that gives it the diffuse quality, or is it movement,
there's something that I use, and I've intentionally just kept that as a secret. I just feel like it's beneficial.
There's enough artists in the audience that they understand. Sometimes you sort of say the last thing you do.
The way it came about was, it was almost magical in a sense of like working in the studio and working in a certain direction and then seeing something that made me look at things differently. And so I wanted to explore that. And so with the material that I was using and the way that I was approaching the photograph, that was what was exciting to me. And then when I started to explore and really see what they were looking like, there's a magic in it that I feel like if you don't know, it's kind of more.
Well, it's interesting because you've done painting and photography. And these, in a sense, are sort of photographs that look a lot like painting.
Right,
and yet that wasn't necessarily what you set out to do. You're describing a process that sounds almost like an accidental discovery.
Yes, and I feel like that's part of what, as an artist, as my art practice, I'm always trying new things and exploring new, like the pyrography, for instance. That's something that I love to do, and then I love to paint, and then I.
Pyrography from the Greek, meaning to write with fire. Slightly different than photography, which is lighting with light, but it's just a little bit more specific.
Right.
I read that in the press release. I thought that it was a good piece of information. That's all too.
I feel like approaching photography like a painter, mm-hmm. in the sense of like what I wanted to achieve. Now, like I look at that one piece as an example, like it almost feels
the one with the hat,
right? You know, it almost feels like it's like a palette knife, mm-hmm. you know. And so with this process, I could manipulate everything up until the point that I take the picture. So. A lot of these, when I first started exploring the process, I was doing self-portraits, so I had to take pictures of myself. So I'd have to not see what it's looking like.
Oh, until later.
And then I would take the picture and I'd walk over and then get behind the camera and like look and be like, okay, like I really like what's going on here, and I have to figure it out, you know, how to get what it is that I wanted from it. And then that process changed when I started to bring models into the studio. And then I could really see, and I could do the minor changes and different things. I mean, it was like, it's crazy how, I mean, I almost feel like I want to talk about the process and how it's done.
I can tell them. I
can see your face. You're like, tell them. Don't you say a word.
Surface. Mm-hmm. So then what are you like liquid light coating it? I mean, how are you making the paper? Or is it that by the time you go to print, it's a digital file and you can print on anything? Or is it?
Yeah, this is all shot digital. It's all shot on a digital camera. And then the printing of them, I try everything. This is my first time doing a photography show and exploring that medium. So I wanted to learn as much as I could. And, see what suited this medium the best, and because they feel like paintings and they have that painterly quality, the rice paper just stood out, you know, right. Above the rest, like night and day. And they have like a tactile quality, like you can feel the grain, and it's almost like
a linen, almost like,
yeah,
like you get, right. Like, the surface seems like a painted surface, as right. Well as the way the image is.
Yeah.
And then I was laughing when you were saying self-portraiture. So I'm looking at this woman with the hat and her bald haircut. I think about Rembrandt because it looks literally like not even a Rembrandt painting, though it does a little, but actually specifically the endless self-portraits, where he was trying out techniques and new pigments and new resin formulas and all that stuff on himself. And so there's this weird kind of thing with the palette and the resolution and the scale that it makes it seem even more like those things that are being referenced, a candle in a wine bottle, you know, so that it has this kind of synergy between, so, you know, I don't feel like I'm looking at pictures of contemporary humans or, you know, right. A hipster apartment with like retro stuff in it and this crazy technique. Like there seems to be a real melding of what you're depicting is, you know. So is that something that happened because once you started to realize what this was gonna look like, did you think I wanna match make that with subjects? Or, you know, at what point did it stop being an accident, I guess is what
right.
I'm really asking.
Yeah, and then once I experimented it to got it to a point where I had this look, that this feel, that this that everything in here has, then, you know, that's what the process was, getting it to that point. And then once I had my setup, and it was like just knocked them out, and that was fun. It's like, okay, now what story do I want to tell? What do I want to explore? And it was this feeling of like specific characters and personalities, because you can't see details, you can feel them. You can feel, you know, this woman is like, you feel this, you know, so I got to direct and say, okay, give me this, like, you know, this rich, like, you have all this money, and you have all this confidence, you own all this land, and what does that feel like? How do you hold yourself? And so, you know, working with the models to do that, and, you know, yeah, it's just like,
and then the choices is still life. Mm-hmm. So you're calling it pyrography because fire.
No, pyrography is the when I burn the wood.
Oh, pyrography when you burn the wood. Okay. Right. So, but this technique, there does seem to be, the lighting seems to be sort of a flame-based candle light, you know, kind of low warm light kind of thing like that. That, and then of course there's actual fire as content in several of them.
Right.
So do you feel like there's a relationship between both the burning wood and kind of like what that was in terms of the ink and the resolution and the way that it seemed on the page and what you're doing, or is that just kind of like a it's fascinating kind of inspirational coincidence? Like, how do you?
Well,
because I realize I'm trying to ask you questions where you can't really answer because the real answer is like, well, it's related because I do the same thing. Oh. Right? Like, so I'm trying to help you stay cagey.
Yeah. I mean,
for now.
In my studio, there's like a collection of blowtorches and different. You know, so, and that's something I like to play with. I like to play with fire. So it works in the figurative nature when I do the pyrography on wood, but obviously I'm not doing that here. But there's something, so I started to explore that deeper. What does it mean to like, what is, why am I interested in it? Why do I want to light things on fire? And it has a, you know, transformative quality.
Because it's awesome to light things on fire.
Right.
Why does anybody like everybody likes to light things on fire, right?
Yeah.
Right. All right. Just as an aside. But I mean, that's a very human, you know, non-art historical, it's just like one of those fundamental human things. Why do we stare at fire? Why do we play with matches? Why do we love, PAL TV, the flickering, like, there's something.
So I'm not the only one.
No, but I mean, not only the only one in this room, probably, but I mean, you know, that kind of sort of pyromania that stops short of actually, like, destroying, you know, personal property of others is something that's kind of magic. I mean, you mentioned magic, alchemy is, you know, based entirely on the transformative properties of fire and chemicals and, you know, all that whole, and like that whole kind of science and industry that was coal burning and you know, looking for the lead into gold was kind of what was also going on at the time that painting looked like these.
Right. There was
there's just another thing that kind of dovetails with all of it, even if it didn't start out.
Sure. Yeah, I definitely see that for sure.
Yeah.
But I'm definitely attracted to warm light, like my. Where I live, it's very warm lighting. It's very, you know, that's something that I'm attracted to, and I want to communicate that through this work as well.
You're even setting them up fire alarms. I have a question too about the differences between the models and the still lifes, because it seems to me like some of what's kind of magical and emotionally kind of intriguing or engaging about the work is just the like ever so slight presence of the mystery of what you're looking at, even though it's legible. So you were saying, you know, you there's not a huge amount of resolved detail in the way that someone's face is, but still the expression reads, you know. So when you are casting, as you were saying, bringing in models, knowing how ambiguous the image was going to look in the end, how much did it sort of matter who the people were? Like, were these like people you know just saying, I have an idea, can you ask your mom? Or was it like, you know, you put out an ad for people that had a certain look? Like, how controlling of that were you going into?
I mean, it really mattered. I wanted to bring in people that could keep their mouth shut.
That's why you call, I get it.
Right. No, so really it was because it was a private process, I brought in people close to me. So for instance, my mother, who's, you know, very supportive of my work, my girlfriend, my sister, my brother, who actually didn't make it to the photo shoot, but this is a picture of my father, and so he has a quality. You know, he was an actor his whole life, and so he had a he you know, he's got the white hair, and he would play a priest. He could play a priest or play a, you know, a judge, or, and so I took that and, had an idea of what I wanted to do with that image, obviously being inspired, you know, Francis Bacon, the study of the screaming priest. So this is kind of a nod to that, or screaming pope. So this is like the priest version of that. And I was able to direct him and get him to a place that really had a feeling to it. And we had a lot of fun playing dress up, and it's another example.
Well, I like the one back there a lot, that the most modern, just because.
Oh, yeah.
Because, like, that is something you could not mistake for maybe it's a close-up detail of a painting, right?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
You might find that any of these kind of have that quality of maybe somebody went in and kind of, like, pulled a detail out of the corner of a painting, you know, like, it has, like, but not that one. That one's obviously, like, you didn't find that. It wasn't, like, a secret guy in the back of the night watch. Right? So then, so there are these moments of sort of contemporary humor and different things like that that enter into, you know, this project that's about, you know, art history and old time technique. So, without, again, not revealing too much of it, but, you know, because there are these little sort of moments of humor, yet the rest of it is very somber and very sort of meditative. And I guess I'm wondering, I love the story about this being your dad, and not only, but it's also a Francis Bacon meaning. So as we go through, you don't have to do like every single one of them, but as some of them, maybe like tell a little bit of, was this just something that like, there's candles and wine bottles on my table, or was it like, I want to do something that has, you know, a La Boheme quality to it? Like, how deliberate, and I guess how personal, maybe, are some of your favorite pictures here?
Right.
As opposed to just kind of formal, knowing that it would look this way.
Yeah, it was. What I love about the process is like, you don't know what it's gonna look like and what it's gonna come out as. So there was a lot of exploration. And so lighting things on fire, obviously we talked about, is a lot of fun. So this is a wine bottle that I doused and lit on fire. And you know, there was different versions of it. There's one that's like the whole thing is fire. There's one where it's more subtle. So it's getting to pick those, the ones that really stand out. But on top of it, there's a lot of text in my work, you know, what I've done in the past. And so immediately there was words and things that would come up immediately when I would see a piece. And that is as much of a part of this show as just the visual end of it, you know. And I didn't want to put text on the work because it would be too distracting, but the text is a big part of it, like this one here that has that Rembrandt feel, and you know, it's she's so fucking rich, but it doesn't define her, you know. And it's like these things that like would come to me so almost like a meditative state that you get in when you are creating and making art, and then these phrases would pop up, and I didn't judge them, I didn't, you know, try to work on them too much. It's like it either feels right or it doesn't, and that was a really.
What's that one called?
That one's the middle finger is it was the punk scene where he felt most comfortable.
Oh,
so it's like, okay. Right. So it's like I picture this, and a lot of it like tells these stories to me. Like there's this guy who's at this, he's at like CBGB's at the punk show, and he's just like, you know, just fuck you, that's where he feels comfortable.
Yeah.
That's where he doesn't do well at, you know.
Her house.
Exactly.
right? You wouldn't do so well in her house. It's probably her grandson. But I mean, it's funny to play that game because you leave so much ambiguity,
right,
obviously, on the table for people to play with.
Right.
That, I would imagine that would be kind of an interesting sort of cycle. You know, titling these would be a fun game for sort of anyone
trying
to imagine, because it has, it strikes that very specific balance between somewhat directed thought and plenty of room for you to decide.
Right.
So I'm going to go around and I'm going to be like, okay, that reminds me of La Boheme because it's candle and wine bottle, even though I now know that's not really what it is, but you know what I mean? And it's going to be those things for me, and then it's going to be a whole separate set of things for you and for everyone.
Right.
And you might look at this one of the fire back there, and some people might think it's destruction, some people might think it's religious, maybe just because it's Easter you're thinking about that or not, or I don't know. I mean, I'm Jewish, I don't care, but I mean, I look at like a burning fire, and it's like, I think funeral pyre, I think burning bush. It looks, you know, somewhat menacing, but somebody else might look at it and think just like, you know, that it is massaging their eyes and they can hear the crackle and it's, you know, beautiful and not in any kind of dark or light or spiritual way, you know.
Yeah.
So every single person, I mean, that hat that she has on is going to look Asian to some people, but not to everyone. And the rim is going to, like, it's catching magic hour light, but other people aren't even going to notice that because they're going to be much more concerned with how obvious it is that she's beautiful even though you can't see anything. You know, like, every single one of these has any sort of, maybe infinite, because there's images. So it's not infinite.
All right.
So,
the ambiguity is something that I was really excited about.
Yeah,
my
that's
work in the past has been
very specific.
Very specific and very clear. And it's like, you either get it or you don't, you know? Where this, you can get so many different things from it. That is something I'm exploring in my work, you know.
What's that about you? I'd love to hear more about like what you feel like that change is about.
It's, you know, it's this battle of when you do a clear figurative piece of it being one note, you know, especially if you use text. And so I've always done my best to keep it ambiguous as possible. Like, not, you know, so there was not that specific clear message, but it gets difficult. And I wanted to explore that more and more, this idea of not knowing, you know, what you're gonna get, not knowing what it is, but at the same time still communicating a feeling that I feel like accomplishing a lot of that.
And for you, that is personal, but not like crazy deep, private personal. Like it's personal, but it's not like you know what I mean? It's not difficult material.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that it has a personal resonance for you, but then an art historical resonance as well. So there's some continuum of those two things,
mm-hmm.
kind of as you. How many of these have you? When you didn't start doing this that long ago?
No, I mean, I've done photography for a long time, but never nothing like this. I mean, this.
How many of these are there? I mean, are these all of them? Or
no,
is there like a you know?
There's a massive folder of images, and I just went through and picked my favorite 16, which ended up filling up the room really nicely, and gave it a really good vibe. So.
Yeah, no, it definitely. They need the space too, you know, because there's so much you want to kind of get up in there, and so much of the best parts are like these little subtle, you know, little backgrounds, like kind of like Brandy. I don't know what that's, but yeah, that's I guess it's a shadow on some kind of, you know. Okay, without divulging, here's like whole secret sauce thing. How much of the palette is because that's what you wanted it to be versus because that is the inevitable result of the way that you light the images?
Right, no, you can light them anyway. And I explored with, you know, what is it gonna look like with a pop image? You know, really bright and the, you know, color, I can.
So there's fluty, like cherry red and
totally.
Vermilion. If you wanted it, if it was in the object, it would be in the picture.
Right, and I explored that, like really bright fluorescent pinks and to see what that would, you know, changing the light, not using a warm light, using something really, really white and cold. And that's a whole other show. I mean, this, I can really explore this, and I want to, and I'm going to, you know, on a bigger scale and on a different kind of feeling, quality of the work.
Yeah, I was gonna ask about scale and whether that was like a paper restriction, like, you know, sometimes the most gorgeous handmade paper in the world. They only come that big. That's how big. Sorry, they're monks in Japan, right. And that's how big it is. Right. You know, there's no other sizes available. Or versus whether it was, again, how much of that was your decision versus what the materials dictated.
Right. It came down to, well, I mean, a lot of it comes down to the space that you're showing in, too. You know, not to get off topic, but. the work, it becomes more and more abstract and bigger it gets, you know. So when you bring it down, it really tightens up and you can see it a little more. I mean, there's still images that I know what it is, but people look at it and they're like, I have no idea, like this one here, that's a sunflowers in a vase on fire. Obviously.
I didn't realize, at this point in myself, I didn't realize they were on fire because I obviously know where I am and clearly they should be on fire. But I got flowers in a vase.
You did?
I didn't get sunflowers. Okay. I was thinking, or get some kind of Ikebana.
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
but
you know,
it's hard to light flowers on fire.
It's fun.
I'm just saying, if they're living or recently alive, they're wet. I mean, inside. Like,
yeah, well, yeah.
You know, you right. have to do. Look at his face right now. Look at the expression on his face right now. All he's doing is thinking about lighting sunflowers on his leg.
You know, and it got to a scary point of me wanting to light the subjects on fire. I don't do that.
Good.
You know, might get in trouble but how fucking cool would that be?
I mean, you could pretend, maybe like the fire jet protected.
Yeah, yeah. I mean,
you'd have to move quickly, but nobody needs to get hurt.
I've got a lot to explore. I mean, I did light a mannequin on fire.
Okay, but it melts, it doesn't really burn.
Or two
melts.
I have this gel that's part of my photography process where it's a fire retardant gel.
Right.
So I have that. So I coated the head in that, and then later on, I'm like, well, this didn't melt. Maybe I can try it on mom. Like sure. You know.
Maybe. Probably not. Oh my god, be so great. They're like, I'm totally torn right now. Cause I'm like, God, why don't you do that? But then. I can't really advocate.
I mean, I think it'll happen.
Yeah, I want you to do that.
Yeah.
I don't know. Volunteer crisis. People are volunteering.
Exactly.
You'll get things in LA. Like, you'll get five people. Oh, yeah. I think you should.
Sign this here.
Yeah, job on this. Fancy art show, nonprofit. It'll be great. But vis-a-vis the ambiguity of the image and the scale, I'm glad you actually brought that up because that was another question is, are we talking about scale where it's this image but it would be bigger, or are we talking about a process like photography where past a certain point the file size is just starts to disintegrate the
right.
image?
I mean, the camera that I can use, that I own, I could go bigger, I could go probably twice the size of this. Now if I wanted to go bigger, I would rent a really high, you know, megapixel camera to do it. But the other thing is with this process, it's where the subject moves away from the camera, how far or close they are determines on how distorted it gets. So
we just learned something. Try really hard.
So that was something.
The subject is in proximity motion, not
right.
necessarily just general motion, but like
right. So if I tighten So you can tighten up.
I don't know what that means, but I feel like I know something.
It's over here.
Right? No, but I mean that's because when you think of like a moving subject, you don't necessarily think of it moving laterally in that direction in terms of approach and retreat from the camera. You think of moving in their plane, and then maybe traces of those motions making it into the film. But you don't necessarily think of a subject's motion as being in relationship to the camera placement distance.
Right.
You think of it as moving on your proscenium, and that, you know, it's a different way, you know, it's a different way of talking about moving in a picture plane than I feel like I've heard about.
Okay.
So that's interesting.
Yeah. And that'll determine how like fuzzy or how distorted it gets or how crisp it is. So if I feel like if I went bigger and you still wanted to see the image, I would probably bring them closer to tighten it up.
So you've been thinking about maybe
make it bigger.
Yeah, I mean, you kind of always want.
Always, yeah, you're always seeing, you know, this is like step one of this process. And, you know, I think because I do work in different mediums, you got to be careful not to like just, oh, I do watercolor and I paint this and I do and I burn this. It's like, no, you have to really explore it, really push yourself to get the best out of that medium as you can. And I think this is so specific that I really have a lot of room to play with. You know, like full size, full body images, landscapes. It's fun. But I've stepped away from it as of right now. You know, like I really went crazy and got this, and then but definitely come back to it.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think the fire is not only like a great hook and really, you know, it's funny and it's dramatic and it's emotional and it's all those things that, which is why people, you know, love it. But I think it also has the benefit of being kind of a conceptual through line between the work that you've done before.
Right.
And so, you know, not to just be like the fire guy, but it's sort of like, you know, you could have taken those works and thought you could have gone in a different, in a number of directions. It could have been, let me explore other kinds of writing in human history or other deployments of text or that, the other kinds of language versus, you know, let me see what else I could do with fire, you know, which is what you did. But I mean, so it's connected, but it's not, but it is a departure at the same time. How have you, I mean, are people kind of on board with the move? Do you feel like people have followed you to here?
I mean, yeah, definitely. I mean, it's establishing that, like, I just don't do, like, biography, or I just don't paint, you know? And I think because the response to this work was so positive, it's encouraging, and that people understand that, you know, I do, you know, part of my process is exploring different mediums. That's what I get enjoyment out of. You know, I'm not gonna, you know, I think as a businessman, it maybe it makes it a lot harder, you know, because I don't have
that. James is like, yeah. You know, like, what's your
brand, you know? And I think that's can be an ugly word for an artist, you know?
It can be. Like, I mean, it can be a good at that. I mean, and not to be like, whatever, but we got here, we can give our host a little bit of love, but that's part of the reason that this space is conceived and operated as a nonprofit, because you have fewer of those kinds of pressurized concerns.
Right.
So when an artist who's a painter comes and says, I have this amazing video piece, or I'm doing this experiment, James has a lot more ability to just be genuinely enthusiastic and supportive and kind of show that, where a gallery program that had an agenda, had done well with your previous work, might have been more resistant.
Sure.
So, I mean,
that's part of, so
but it's true, because that moment, I'm sure a lot of the artists that are here, that moment where you are in a place where you want to do something different is exciting, and it's a lot of other things, like scary and horrifying to your dealers, and confusing to some writers, and vaguely off-putting to some collectors who aren't sure if they're allowed to still like the other stuff or what. And, you know, all of that messy, it should be this kind of exciting moment. I've had a breakthrough, I'm trying something new, and everyone should be, but yet it doesn't really play out like that the time.
Yeah, and it's great to have Launch and James open and embrace that idea of like, look, this is a place where you can really explore and try things. And really happy, you know, with it, you know, and how it went. And so I'm glad people have been responsive to it.
Yeah.
Because it is, you're wondering. Yeah. You know, especially collectors that have bought like my biography. It's like, oh, are you not doing that? And it's like, no, I still do it, just not right now, you know?
Okay.
Yeah, right.
Right, so, because then they don't know if that means you realized all that stuff was horrible and stupid.
No, it's different. It's a different.
You're like, no, that is still amazing and I loved it, but I'm doing this now. And that can be a very tricky moment. You know, by the way, you're also making brand new work in the studio and going through that while you're having this kind of public conversation. Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm doing something a little different, I can't really tell you. You know, so it's just, it's fascinating just on that level too, like quite separate, you know, from, you know, the deal with the work itself, is that moment in an artist's career is also very Interesting.
And I love, I mean, I one of my favorite shows that I've seen in the last couple of years was the Lynn Folk Show at The Hammer.
Yeah.
And that's somebody, he worked in so many different mediums and different things. And I remember there's the, he did these giant rock paintings, you know, like these monochromatic rock paintings that just sold. And his dealers were like, you need to make more of these.
Right.
And he was like, he just didn't want any. He's like, yeah. I want to keep being an artist. I'm not a, you know, if you want that, you can, there's, in China, which I'm fascinated by, are these factories where you can get, you send them a photograph and they send you a painting that's
an oil painting rolled up in a tube. I know, and they're like pretty good.
I mean, there's something about, and that's what I love about.
But they're very similar.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I'm going, I mean, that's a little tangent to that. I'm going later to, my friend Eric White is having a book signing at Lely's tonight, and he's a brilliant painter, but one of the things he did recently was he wanted, people were after him to give himself a, like to organize a retrospective survey, but he didn't kind of want to waste a gallery exhibition slot on that. So he sent all of his images of the last previous 10 years to China, got back 1/3 scale ones of them, painted a long, you know, a line at this part, and then installed them like it was a survey of his show, but it only took up 1/3 of the space. And it's a whole piece. And that was part of what he was talking about, was this idea of like, if that was handmade by someone. So there's still this hand of the artist thing, but it's, you know, so I mean, I guess if you wanted, I mean, you know, you could do, oh my God, you could get those and then you could light those on fire. Sorry, I'm married now, but like, I'm really feeling like this could go on forever.
Right.
And there's a performative element of this that's, you know, kind of begging to happen. Is that something that you've given any, that you've given
fire?
Thought to? Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, for sure. I mean, there's a
right?
Piece
I mean,
that
I, right? A performance that involves some sort of live fire.
I mean, we've talked about it, and it's, you know, there's a, unless you go out to the desert, which has been an option, you have to get, you know, the fire marshal and permits and code, which is fine, but it's, I have this vision of a giant, like, wood panel that I take up, like, a massive flamethrower and make the piece with that, and so that's been in the works, and that's been something that I've been going towards, and I think, yeah, I would invite my audience.
Yeah, definitely. Well, because then, of course, there's the idea of photographing or videoing that, so that's sort of like part pyrographia, part this at that point. Do you know what I mean? Like, you get this kind of hall of mirrors a little bit, where the threads kind of convened. You know, rags would be like lit by fire and movement, but yet in the service of this other thing that's older but with the scale. You know what I mean? I'll talk about that later. PM me later. I'm sorry, I meant to say before that we should let people ask questions at any point throughout. I always forget to say that beginning. But if you have questions, don't feel like you have to wait till the end.
What kind of studio do you have?
I have just a big long rectangle, 12-foot ceilings, probably 15.
Oh, okay, so
right, yeah, so I can go, yeah, not like in a
apartment.
Everywhere. I keep it pretty contained. I mean, I'm comfortable with the flammable substances that I use, and that's come through trial and error. So yeah, some things I've gotten out of hand in the past, but started outside, so then I know I can bring it inside.
So do you wear a flame retardant coveralls or something?
No.
Yeah. No, like fireman gear.
Yeah. And are the fire marshals on to you, or, you know, do you carry special insurance?
When they come over, there's a, you know, it's photography, it's works like this, so they don't know.
Got it.
Artist and painter.
Yeah. Right, so no problem.
No.
Yeah. Excellent. And neighbors flying a bit.
Right.
Yeah.
It's okay.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's the question, because this is very, I mean, I believe you that you have like a system and it's handled and it's cool and no one's in like danger, but I could also see, you know, another, like, you know, it has a slight crazy person quality to it. The idea of like, you know, the kind of process, which now we're all just sort of left to imagine because you won't tell us everything, which is fine. But I mean, like, you know, the idea of like, you know, it's, I think about like that Tom Waits song, like, what's he building?
Right, there, right.
You know what I mean? Because I'm sure there's smells and all kinds of other things besides just open flame. But I'm sure that's been true with all along. I don't think that's not new to these. That's always been a consideration.
Sure. I mean, I've always loved the smell of burning wood. You know?
Right.
So that kind of permeates the studio, which is nice. It's like a comforting feeling.
Yeah.
At least to me now.
You probably always smell a little bit like you've been camping, right? Yeah. Yeah. A little bit.
Right.
Just always.
Always.
Is that right? Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, it's very, I'm, you know, it's really, it's kind of, it's settling in, because I know that, I know we've been talking for half an hour about how they're photography, and I still want to call them paintings when I'm looking at them. I still want to say that painting.
Right. And that's such a, that's like, I feel like I've accomplished at that point, you know, and that's exciting that I was able to do it, and people really respond and get that.
Yeah. Yeah, they're quite beautiful, and haunting, and totally weird, and you know, like, not creepy in a bit, like, just a little bit, like, just like 5%, you know, among the sort of, like, capital R romance of the, you know. And again, I love that there's a relationship to art history as well as just to your personal kind of what you feel like doing in the studio. And then out of the outgrowth of that is a kind of new hybrid technology that, I guess, you should copyright, and then you can tell people about it. You know, I don't know what's new yet. But, you know, definitely I'm still kind of trying to figure it out, which I think is fine. I mean, I think let me do that, because let me continue to think about it and try to unravel that puzzle, because that's a way of getting people to spend more time with the images in a world of just like, oh yeah, right. Yeah, oh, that's pretty cool. Oh, I've saved that one. Oh, and Instagram, well, it's not square, and, you know, and even people who love it behave that way. So to have something that is unresolvable is a really, it's a little bit of like a mind worm, like it gets in there and you're still like, okay, well maybe it's a, but then that wouldn't explain, you know, and so, you know, my boyfriend's a photographer, believe me, we're going to be trying to figure this out. For at least some of I am. I'm going to be asking him all kinds of questions about what he thinks, you know, because it, and so even though in a way that's not what the work is about, because there's allegory and there's narrative and there's symbolism and there's a lot of other things, I feel like it kind of is about that. So, you know, to leave that in the same column as the other kinds of ambiguity, actually, all kidding aside of like, you can tell me.
Right.
I think that's actually kind of brilliant that you aren't leading with that. Uh-huh. You know, I think it's like it's a good decision.
Right. Actually, I want people to feel the work and not be so concerned of like, oh, this is how it's done.
And yet a little bit, because when you're trying to figure out how it's done, you're all up in it. Mm-hmm. You know, you're like, you're gonna look at it for 10 minutes instead of 10 seconds, and you're gonna think about it later, and you're gonna get it close and go far and do all that stuff in the service of trying to unsolve the riddle. So it kind of serves the narrative, even though it's a side part, yeah.
I'll just talk of secrecy, kind of reminds me of David Hockney's book on this secret knowledge. It talks about like the old masters and how it puts forth this idea that they used this early version of photography before we had a way of putting it in print. And towards the completion of these masterpiece paintings. And it's interesting that you are also using some kind of secret knowledge, but in a way to do sort of the opposite. Like they were trying to make these images that were more representational and tighter and more realistic, and you're kind of going in another direction, back towards making photography more like painting. Mm-hmm. And so I was kind of wondering, in part, like, well, is that like a very conscious thing? Like, one of the things that Hockney kind of gets at by the end of it is that this, at least for me, it was this idea that there are these different phases in the history of photography, and it started off kind of with painting, and then it became something separate. And now in the digital age, they're merging again, and are becoming all mixed up again. And I'm kind of curious about, like, the fact that you're using digital photography, although you're not doing any post-production kind of stuff, is it necessary to this whole process that it's digital, or could you do the same thing with the,
with film?
Yes.
Yeah, it could. I mean, these could just be, printed from negatives, but there's really no, it wouldn't change anything for me, just ease of use, really, just using technology to a point. Because I feel like you could probably come close to creating these images on a computer,
Right.
I wasn't interested in that, but when I did see, when it happened and I saw what they were, it's like, wow, these look like paintings. And that was knowing that they're not, and knowing it, and like you said, you go from a point of painting to have things look like photographs, and then that's been done. There's plenty of artists that can do that. But now to take a photograph and make it look like a painting, I thought was just a really fun thing to play with.
I agree with that, especially because you don't necessarily think of photography as something that is, one thinks of photography as something that's in the service of sort of accuracy and legibility, and obviously that's a blanket statement that has nothing to do with all the sort of like fine art permutations, but as a general matter, I love your comment, because it used to be that painting was good or bad depending on how much like reality it looked. Mm-hmm. Then you had cameras that could do that. So then people would say that liberated painting from the burden of the job of faithful representation,
right.
And so that's how painting got to be abstract. And then photography was like, well, I want to be expressive and humanist too, so screw you. And then photography started to be all kinds of interested in manipulations and abstractions and all these other things. And then painting was like, well, fine, if you're going to do that, then I'm going to go back to narrative, figurative, technique-based art, and we're seeing that right now with, So it really is this sort of, this rabbit hole of this tussle that they're in. And I definitely feel like there's a degree where this is kind of like right on the cusp, straddling those feuding camps, So that's a really nice point about the camera obscura and all that kind of like, what are you using it for? That's interesting. Because of course they are photography now, and so you're now in a whole other stream of art history. So that's parallel, but not the one you've been swimming in.
Well, now this is pushing me to use, because I wanted to take a blowtorch and make a burn an image that looked like something that was figurative, that really was representational. And then now that I've done that, now I want to push it this way, where it's, how can I, invoke more of a feeling or more of an abstract quality?
So there's just a contrarian kind of strain that runs through the whole, whatever it is. Got it. That makes sense. How many different colors can I make out of this pencil?
Right.
I feel like I like that too. Yes, sir.
When you started out to explore this, did you reach your intention, or was this something like a diversion along the way that you went, oh, no, that's it?
I mean, I had the show lined up here, and I started exploring an idea like within my photography work, doing that. There was an aspect of it that I was bringing different things into the studio that I'd never worked with to combine with it, to push that level of, to push my photography as far as I could. And within that, I saw something in the studio that caught my eye, that I said, okay, that's in that same realm, let me go explore that. And it led itself to, photography being the best way to communicate it. And you know, I feel like I'm being so vague because I can't say what it is that I use. But
we got a couple of things out of you, probably more than you realize.
Yeah. I didn't know what it was going to be. I didn't set out to make a show that looked like this. It was really being open and saying yes to a lot of things and not shutting it down because it wasn't. This isn't what I do, or this isn't what my intention is. It was like, here's something really interesting. Let's explore it because you can. Yeah.
Excellent.
That's a beautiful artist statement. You know, any artist that can say that about their work and trusting themselves and their process to create something that they're really not aware of really is kind of.
Like, let's dive
the
in.
It's the essence of what I think a lot of us are going for as artists.
I agree. Well said,
James. When I look at it, it's almost like a Nietzsche experience. You know, I don't know if you know the writings of Nietzsche, but there's this feeling of no one can know what's in the mind of the other person they're speaking to, except the person that is speaking, which often doesn't know. You know, but there's this feeling of this, when I look at your work, that it's not a moment, it's in the moment, where you're kind of trying to decipher what the meaning is. And I think that's the fascination of the work, the fact that it's this Nietzsche type of feeling of we really don't know what is being meant to say, be said. And to find
and
that.
And yet you have to.
You have
proceed
to proceed.
It's possible to.
And that's what draws you to the work. You find for yourself there's this psyche to it for yourself. As
yeah, well. I mean, when I see the image all like a very specific, especially these three on this wall, they're like very specific characters. And they have a dialogue that's going on within them that I play with in the title, that I kind of, just whatever that feeling is, and that's, you have to name them, and it was just so fun to do that, to tell this whole story. So I guess speaking to that, I think in that capacity, but not, I don't know if it goes any deeper.
Yeah, because it's almost to me like you can have a conversation with these pieces. That there's something more there.
Because I'm just She means people and experiences and impressions. Jody, definitely could. I mean, you could go very good backstory, I think, on a lot of things given your I totally see what that would be like. Yeah, no, I love that. And I think that's what I mean, is like you give people enough information that they have permission to search for meaning. Because there's enough information that you know it means something, right? But you have to kind of do the rest. And so that's when that kind of engagement kind of happens. Mike Street, what did you want to say?
You know, I love the work. And I noticed that the compositions seem very, very intentional and simple. You know, it's not a big crowd scene. It's like Shana said, kind of zeroed in on the detail. And I was wondering how much cropping was involved. I mean, did you really intend this to be the star of your image, or did you kind of like, ooh, hey, that little piece is really interesting.
Yeah, right.
No, I mean, it's like, I love that. It's like painters ask their question. It really, and all of these concerns exist in the work. You know, photography concerns, meaning concerns, culture, so yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, like, I would say 95% of the work that I shot and that's printed is the full frame. So the cropping is done. The ones that I did, the self-portraits, were a little trickier because like getting right into the right spot was tricky. But for the other ones, they were definitely the full frame because I wanted to maximize the quality of the image.
But there is a simplicity, you know, like a great simplicity.
Yeah, that was a big part of it, is that it was just, I wanted to communicate a feeling and a from it. Because you can't see the detail of what certain things are, and then you can kind of create those in your mind.
Right, and then that's when it kind of has you.
Right.
That's when you finish the story, and then you're good.
Good.
Well, maybe someday you'll let everybody know how you feel. Until now, what you were able to share with us. That's really wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming on Saturday.
Yeah.
It's amazing. I know. It's great.
Really appreciate it.